Basic properties of real functions such as continuity and differentiability are defined in terms of limits. They are defined in a similar way for complex functions, so we will need limits first if we would like to differentiate functions, for example. In this video, we will learn the definition of a limit of a complex function, and as you will see, it closely resembles the limit of a real function. So what does it mean? Limit z to z0 f of z equals w0, that means that formally, for all epsilon bigger than 0, there exists a delta such that you can get f0 as close to w as you want. You can get the norm of fz minus w0 smaller than this epsilon, provided you take z close enough to z0. So let's look at it graphically. What does this mean? Well, here we have our w0. It means that for any radius over here, you can find another radius over here, such that all values which are mapped, which are in this region, are mapped inside the epsilon circle. Thus, as soon you can get as close as you want to the point w0 with all your function values at w, provided you chose the circle over here in your domain small enough. So you can get as close as you want to w0, provided your z's are very close to z0. That's what the definition says. Now let's try to use it. So let's use it in a limit which is pretty obvious, just to see how the definition works. We have f of z equals item z bar over 2. And if you take the limit for z to 1, should not nothing special really going on, you could just plug it in and you see the limit would be I over 2. So why is that true? Why does it hold according to the definition? Well, then we need to show that this quantity, fz minus w0, can become arbitrarily small provided we take z close enough to 1. Well, this quantity, the modulus of fz minus w0 is in this case fz minus w0 minus I over 2. Well, you can take the I over 2 out and then you get the modulus of I over 2 times modulus of z bar minus 1. Now, the modulus of I over 2 is just 1 half. And the modulus of z bar minus 1 equals the modulus of z minus 1. And why is that? If you have the 1 and either the z or the z bar, the distance to the 1 is the same. So the modulus of z bar minus 1 is the same as the modulus of z minus 1. Now you know that it's given that its modulus of z minus 1 is smaller than delta. So you know that your modulus of fz minus w0 is smaller than delta over 2. And you want to get it smaller than epsilon, so what should you do? How should you choose your epsilon? You want the delta over 2 to be equal to this epsilon, so you choose your delta equal to 2 epsilon. If you choose this particular delta, then your fz minus w will be smaller than epsilon. Well, you can do this for any epsilon bigger than 0, which means that this limit equals I over 2. That's how such an argument works if you want to show that a limit exists. Actually, showing that a limit exists is much harder than showing that a limit does not exist. Because how can you show that a limit doesn't exist? Well, let's look at the second example of z over z bar equals x plus iy divided by x minus iy. Well, limits only exist if you get the same limit no matter how you approach, in this case, a zero. So you should get the same number if you approach zero along the x-axis, or if you approach along the y-axis, or if you approach zero along the line y equals x, or if you approach zero along the parabola y equals x squared. If some of those approaches yield different values, then you approach zero in the domain, but different values in the codomain, which means that the limit does not exist. So what happens in this case if we approach along the real axis? Along the real axis we have y equals 0, and then we set x to 0 in order to approach 0. But we have already x over x equals 1, and then taking limit from x to 0 doesn't do anything anymore, we just get 1. If we go along the imaginary axis, along the imaginary axis, we have x equals 0. And in order to proceed to go to 0, we have to take y to 0. However, that's trivial, because if you set already x to 0, we get iy over minus iy equals minus 1. So limit doesn't do anything anymore. So approaching 0 along the x-axis yields a 1 in our codomain. Along the y-axis yields minus 1. But that's not the same value, which means that the limit does not exist. So if you want to show that the limit does not exist, it's actually a bit easier. You just have to find two ways towards, in this case, 0, which yields a different result.